Thank you very much, Wing. Let me first of all thank Tan Sri Jeffrey Chia and then Datu Wing Tai Wu for inviting me to this very important conference and for making me a part of this institution. My talk, I have prepared the slide. Half of it already discussed by previous session. The session of Chalong Pop, Professor Tiam, and then others, the architecture of ASEAN. As we all know, because of the slow progress in the Doha Round and multilateral trade negotiation and APEC, ASEAN has increasingly relied on bilateral and regional trade arrangement, or RTA, to advance their trade and investment objective. I think this is emphasized by Professor Tam. A closer economic link in ASEAN was primarily driven by regional and international production network and supply chains of MNC from Asia, the US, and Europe since 1980. I think this is the expertise of Professor Kimura in the last session. In addition, ASEAN has 4 ASEAN Plus One agreements with China, Korea, Japan, and India. Regional monetary cooperation, as pointed out by Chalong Pop, because of our dissatisfaction with the IMF performance in handling the ASEAN financial crisis in 1997, ASEAN Plus 3 established a network of bilateral arrangement under Chiang Mai initiative in 2000, in the years of 2000. And then in addition, we have that the ASEAN Bond Fund, administered by BIS Regional Office in Hong Kong, to promote the development of domestic bond market. If you have a domestic bond market, this is a very important, very useful to avoid the so-called currency and maturity mismatches. In the past, we were in the mess in 1997 because we borrowed a lot in foreign currency, in short-term capital flow, and then they invested in the long-term real estate and non-trade sector of the economy. That's why we were in the mess. Yeah? Now, to learn from that, we start now pay attention how to develop domestic bond market. So we have that we raise the currency in domestic currency because that the revenue from the golf courses, from real estate, shopping mall are received in domestic currency. And then also, as pointed out by Chalong Pop, we established AMRO, ASEAN Plus T Macroeconomic Research in Singapore, for surveillance and to promote policy dialogue and discussion on mutual interests. In the past, you don't have that. Yeah? Now we have that in Singapore. And then in 2003, our leader called for a closer internal economic integration by establishing the ASEAN Economic Community starting from next year, 2015, and for its full implemented in hopefully in 2020. There are 2 proposals on region-wide FTA in this region, in this area. As pointed by Professor Tam, one is RCEP, a Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. This is the initiative of ASEAN. And second, competing organization is Trans-Pacific Partnership, now fully supported by the US. And also, as discussed by Professor Tam, there are four goals of ASEAN economic cooperation. One is to form a single market and production base in 10 ASEAN member countries. This is very important, yeah? Including free flow of factor of production, capital, skilled labor, and investment, as well as goods and services. To accelerate the development, the agreement set 12 priority sectors in goods and services. The second goal is to promote a competitive economic region by improving competitive policies, consumer protection, intellectual property rights, and infrastructure and taxation. In the past, we only focused on liberalization of trade, but now we move further to on the issue of intellectual property right, competition policies, and other. To promote equitable development through development of SME, an ASEAN collaborative initiative to garner greater capacity of CLMV country, Cambodia, Laos, and Myanmar, we pay special attention for our brothers. Yeah? And then the fourth issue to build a closer link into the global economy through a coherent approach toward external economic relations and enhanced participation in the international production network, or otherwise known as the global supply chain. This is the player. So who are the players in this ASEAN economic grouping? Private sector, including multinational, not like in the past, government sector, state-owned enterprise. This is very important. Yeah? This is very important. RCEP is a initiative of ASEAN, already explained by Professor. Professor Tam, the coverage to achieve a comprehensive and mutually beneficial economic partnership with improvement over the existing ASEAN FTA and CAP with our dialogue partner. The process can be accomplished sequentially as a single undertaking or through any other external economic partners. And then the principle again, open accession, transparency, and economic and technical cooperation to help again our friend in the Cambodia, Laos, and other countries. The principle of RCEP is to facilitate trade and investment by reducing transaction costs for business. This is very important. I will come back to this. How do you do that? Yeah? And then to comply with the WTO agreement. And then starting from initiative or four countries, Singapore, New Zealand, and others, and then later supported by Malaysia and the US, now we have a Trans-Pacific Partnership. The scope and the projected trade liberalization investment goes well beyond what was achieved in other RTA. So this is, again, not only focused on trade and investment, but also on agriculture protection, investor-state arbitration involving foreign investment, stringent intellectual property rights provision, enforceable adherence to ILO labor standard. As somebody pointed out this morning, in this region, we still employ this underage underage manpower. And then also the issue on competition policy, including investment and the state-owned enterprise. Look at state-owned enterprise in Indonesia, 100% owned by the state. It's like in China and in Vietnam. Our bank cannot compete with your Maybank, cannot compete with CIMB, not to mention the Foreign Bank of Singapore. Yeah. So this to be addressed, how to make this a state-owned enterprise of countries like Indonesia, Vietnam, well, like your state-owned enterprise. Maybe you are not happy your state-owned enterprise. Or like state-owned enterprise of Singapore. Singapore, they don't have domestic market for Singapore Airlines. Where do they fly? But SQ is the most profitable airline on earth. Yeah. So I think this is an example how to make the state-owned enterprise profitable. NDPP is regarded as a stepping stone toward a broader regional-wide FTA in Asia Pacific to implement the Bogor Declaration of APEC in 1994. There are two basic issues related to toward a more liberalized RTA, ASEAN Economic Community and globalization, namely one, Asia need to strengthen our institution in order to attract FDI to benefit from RTA and global Asia need to increase efficiency on competitiveness. So the only way to be able to compete in the small market is to increase efficiency and competitiveness. Asia need to address possible polarization and inequity because by nature, globalization would only benefit those with high skilled and creative manpower. How do you do that? You have to train your labor. You have to take care of your needy. Yeah? So, what do you mean by institution? There are three aspects of institution in a market-based economy. First, to improve the legal system to protect private property rights and enforce contract, which are the basic of market economic system. Meaning you have to eradicate in a country like Indonesia corruption. Yeah? Because this is a part of the problem why we have a high transaction cost. Second, to avoid market failure by improving the implementation of prudential rules and regulation. When I was the Auditor General of Indonesia, this is one of the problem, yeah? We had the regulation, but they don't implement it. Yeah, because of, again, corruption. So this is what we have a market failure. And the third one, to eliminate public sector failure by improving competitiveness of state-owned enterprise. Again, how to make our Garuda can compete with Singapore Airlines. Yeah? So these are the issues. How do you do this? And then,
just forward, backward.
In general, All of us in ASEAN countries attract MNC and FDI in order to promote economic growth. Look at your Penang. Look at your industrial zone in Malaysia. Look at Johor. Look at Malacca. Yeah, full of MNC, and they contribute a lot to the progress of your economic growth. Promotion of private sector investment, industrialization, and export of our mature goods. In the past, we are only exporters of tin, mine in this in the Sunway City. Yeah. Now, Mr. Chia developed this mining, become a nice place. Yeah, shopping mall, hotel, and university. And then to upgrade international competitiveness by adopting a policy to make prices of foreign tradable goods expressed in domestic currency higher than prices of domestic tradable goods, or in economic jargon, REER, greater than one. How do you do that? Yeah, one is to adopt competitive exchange rate, yeah, and then to reduce that improve business climate and others. We have the experience in Indonesia. Indonesia during Suharto era, we have over 10 years of oil boom. But at the time, the government managed the exchange rate properly to avoid the Dutch disease. This is the difference between Indonesia and Iran. That was the difference between Indonesia and Nigeria. In Nigeria and Iran, they allowed the exchange rate stronger, meaning that it's much cheaper to buy agriculture product than to produce at home. Yeah? In the case of Indonesia, Suharto used the money properly. Yeah? So we have self-sufficiency in rice. So this is very important. This is very important. But now under SBY administration, sometimes they allow this appreciation in exchange rate. That's why our industry is declining. Yeah, they cannot compete with import. Our durian cannot compete with durian from Penang. Yeah. Oh, I like your durian. Yeah. It's very, very tasty. Very tasty. And then the second issue in this globalization, how to address this inequality after we form this ASEAN economic community. These two can be traced by the difference in labor productivity. Well, again, because economic integration, globalization will give greater benefit to high-skilled labor compared to low-skilled labor. You in Malaysia is much better educated than we in Indonesia. Yeah? Second, access to market. Connectivity is central to integrated and competitive ASEAN. In Indonesia, this is the problem. Yeah? That's why the eastern part of Sumatra is more integrated with you. Malaysia, Penang, Malacca, and Kuala Lumpur, then to Java or to Makassar, yeah? Because of the lack of infrastructure, bad communication. Yeah? Because of the inequality in labor productivity and transportation facility, poor countries are made worse by integration of economic community and globalization. So how to solve the problem? This is the best way to do it, is to improve the training in order to raise worker productivity. I think this has some implication on you. You should open your university more to Indonesian students. Yeah? University in Penang, University Kebangsaan of Prof. Tam, yeah? To train more Indonesian. Yeah? It's cheaper to send students to Malaysia than to Australia or to Harvard. Yeah? So I think this is pretty more appropriate. And then of course the country Indonesia should address this inequality through income taxation. And then also we have to Indonesian problem to rectify to the distorted policy in Indonesia. Look, after the year 2000, after the fall of Pak Soeharto, yeah, we grew very fast simply because of boom in the primary product. Yeah, we sell the coal, we sell the nickel ore, we sell the other mining product. Where to? China and India. Yeah? And at the same time, we send our labor to Malaysia, uneducated, unskilled labor to Malaysia, because we cannot create job at home. That's why they keep coming here. Yeah? So they send home remittance, increase to the foreign exchange revenue, and then in addition to that, we have that capital, short-term capital inflow. That's why we have that appreciation in the rupiah. Now, the boom in primary commodity already ended since 2011, and then you kick out the surplus labor from Malaysia, from Middle East, yeah? This is we have facing now in Indonesia. So this is the problem now we are facing in the country. Indonesia is a labor surplus economy. We have too many people, particularly on Java. Yeah? Population of 240 million. Two-thirds of us live on Java. Land is limited. That's why, again, we have to do something about it. The only way to create job is to promote industrialization. To attract FDI, again, that we have to do many things, including to improve this business climate. And then Wing Tai Wu asked me, what is the Indonesian position in the future? This year we are going to have an election. Yeah? And this paper was finished before Friday of last week. Friday is very important because on Friday last week, Madam Megawati appointed Jokowi as a nominee as a candidate for presidency, supported by her party. This is very important. Yeah, Jokowi is a governor of Jakarta, and he is very popular all over the country because of his honesty, and then also because he solved problem. He has no scandal. Previously, he was, before coming to Jakarta, he was a mayor of a small city in Central Java, yeah, of Solo. But the positive thing about this guy, before he joined the politics, he was the makers of furniture for export market. Yeah? So he's more export-oriented, and he is not like other businessmen in Indonesia, ran seeking inward looking outlook. So this is, I think, that we have that some cautious optimistic about this guy. Because if you look at what happened during the past few months under President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, we are more inward looking and protectionist. Yeah? Look at our trade law. Is a managed oriented trade law. Yeah? Look at that the law of industry. Also, well, there is a government intervention in the law. And then also you look at the latest news on what happened in our mining, yeah? By banning the mining to establish, give incentive for a smelter. In economics, we call it, that create rent-seeking activities and also very high economic protection. So this is again that because we don't know that who are the advisors of Mr. Jokowi, and then also his experience is very limited. I think, I don't know whether he has been to Malaysia or not. Yeah, but again, depend on who are the advisor. But you compare the advisor of Megawati in the past, compare with SBY, I think the quality of advisor of Megawati in the past much better, more democratic than the present administration. So to conclude, it is cautiously optimistic because the new leader, I think he will win the landslide in the next election. Because of his track record, honest but less experienced, and then also export-oriented businessman, I think we'll have the hope that ASEAN economic community will be, well, slowly, yeah, implemented under Jokowi administration. I think I stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much.